Hello, everybody. Hello. Much more response than the usual Sunday morning when I say that. People look at me like, you want me to respond? But yes, good morning. And yes, my name is Michelle Valladares, but if you're feeling adventurous, you could try saying it in Spanish, which is Michelle Valladares. That is how we say it in Spanish. And thank you again for having me here and allowing me to share my story with you guys. It is a pleasure to be here, and I'm super excited to share with you guys a little bit about myself. So just to kind of give you a little bit of background about me, I was born in Kitchener, Ontario. I am first generation Canadian. My parents immigrated from El Salvador, which as you can see on the map there, is a tiny little place that actually is kind of the equivalent to Lake Ontario, about size-wise. So my parents immigrated from El Salvador, hoping to give their family a better life than what was going on at the time. They immigrated around in the 80s and there was a civil war going on, and so they came in hopes of providing for their family. Okay, so I always kind of laugh at this picture and say this looks like my dad's brother or someone, because I rarely see him without a mustache. So this is the three of us, and I just say that, you know, life was great. It was, you know, spending time with my mom. I say to any moms who have gone through this, where their child won't let them do anything without them, bless you, because that was me. And I say my poor mother, because I never let her do anything without being by her side. So be encouraged today, if that was you. And this was basically it. We, you know, lived a life that culturally was Latino, but I also participated in Canadian culture, and I really think that shaped who I am. So I enjoyed being the spotlight for a couple of years. And then this little nugget, as I call him, my younger brother Kevin came into our lives. And we were a family of four. This was us. I think when I knew that my mom was having a baby, I was so excited. I was so excited. And I think since day one, I've kind of been like the second mom for him. So that is us. And here are some other pictures of us being typical Canadians, having a chocolate dipped donut from Tim Hortons. Favorite donut to this day, I have to confess. And this picture here on my left, your right, is probably one of the last pictures I have before we really just went through a lot of change and a lot of things that happened in our lives. So this is a piece I actually left blank for a reason, because it is a part of my story that I'm continuing to build upon, and it is a part that I always feel that continues to grow and continues to be part of our lives. But to give you a bit of background, my family, we used to do road trips all the time. We'd go to the States. We'd go to the South End, we'd go to the East End, to the West End, and it just so happened that at this time, in 2001, we were coming back from Louisiana. I had an aunt who lived there, and we went to go visit her for the summer. So in August 2001 is when our lives really changed. As we were coming back from the trip, we were in Kentucky, still in the States, and the person who was driving behind us was drunk and hit our car. It impacted the car exactly where the gas tank was, causing it to be on fire. Now imagine, my brother was 6 when it happened, and I was 11. At an age where I think we were still in the process of change and of growing up, and it definitely impacted the way that we developed. So to kind of tell you, my dad pulled over to the side, and my dad and my mom, because they were in the front, got out as fast as they could. We were in the back, and the doors on one side were locked. So to this day, there's things that when I close my eyes, I still remember. And I think one of the things that I most remember of that moment was just, you know, the orange, the red, and the yellow. And I remember so clearly, I took off my seatbelt, I took off my brother's, I opened the door, and I said, we have to get out now. So I get out as fast as I could and did what they tell you, you know, stop, drop, and roll, and looked for my parents, and we waited and waited. my 6-year-old brother was not coming out, so we kept calling and calling, and thank God, he was out as well. But by this point, what felt like an eternity really was minutes, but it was enough to impact us to the point where my percentage of third-degree burn was 75% of my total body, and my brother was almost 80%. So it was really something that that changed us forever. This is a picture of, we were taken to Cincinnati to a hospital. I don't know if you've heard of the Shriners Hospital, but we were taken there. We had amazing care. This was, like I said, just a month after. This was a nurse that, bless her, she was, even though she did really mean things to me, as I would say, because she would have to give me, you know, the scrubbing baths to make sure that all the dead cells were gone and that I would not get an infection, which were very painful, but she was always so calm and willing to just help me in that process. But, you know, when I look at this picture, there are two things that stick out to me to this day. And every time I look at this picture and every time I talk about my story, it's still, you know, I relive it every single time that I talk about it. It is something that God has given me the ability to speak. I think that not everybody who has gone through a struggle or a trauma has the ability to do so. But like I said, there's two things, I don't know, I'll let you look at it for just a couple of seconds, but there's two things that stick out to me when I look at this picture.
Is that you or is that Kevin?
That's me. That's me. I was 11, yes, that was me in my fabulous white shirt and olive pants there. But the two things that stick out to me is the first one, my eyes. When I look at my eyes, they look really sad. It was a time of a lot of pain. It was a time of a lot of change. This, around this time, we had lost all independence. And what do I mean by that? Basically, because of the extent of our injury, I had to learn how to walk again because I couldn't do that. I couldn't go to the bathroom by myself. I couldn't feed myself. I wasn't really able to do anything. All the fine motor, all the gross motor was lost. So my eyes really kind of reflected how I was feeling. But the other thing that I kind of look at, I don't know if you can see it, is my teeth. That's gonna get right here. My teeth. So this was pre-braces, let me tell you everybody. This is before I had braces. But what I look at in this picture is the fact that, despite the fact that I'm wearing a plastic face mask, which had to be worn almost 24 hours a day to make sure that our scars would not rise, and pressure garments that we had to wear almost 24 hours a day, I was still trying to smile in this picture. I think this point in my life is when I realized I had to lose my parents' faith and gain my own. It was a moment when, if I didn't know who God was as my Father and as my Savior, this is when I found out who He really was and what His plan was for me. So, you know, sometimes, I think maybe this is how I felt, and I don't know if you've ever experienced this before, but we go through seasons in life when it just seems like things are withering, things are difficult, you know, a season is ending, but I've come to learn that it's a choice. There's a choice how we look at these kind of things, because we can look at our surroundings and our environment and say things are really hard, or we can choose to see life. I don't know if you guys can see, there's a little bird right here, hiding in the picture. It's a choice. It's a choice to look at my surroundings in that moment, to say, you know, I choose to be angry, I choose to be frustrated, or to say, okay, God, what's your plan? So yes, looking between the lines. So as I go back to this picture, I think about this passage in Isaiah 61:3 that says, He will give a crown of beauty for ashes, a joyous blessing instead of mourning, and festive praise instead of despair. I don't know if some of you have seen me in worship. I don't know if some of you have seen me doing that, but it's something that I really enjoy. I don't know if you can tell, but it looks like I truly enjoy it. it's a way that I've connected with the Lord. It's a way that I've found that I choose to praise despite the fact that we were going through a really hard time. And so from 2001 to this point, I want to share with you this scripture that I think for me has just become part of my decree and has become part of me. And I'll read it. It's from Psalm 40, 1-3, it says, I waited patiently for the Lord to help me. and he turned to me and he heard my cry. He lifted me out of the pit of despair, out of the mud and the mire, I think my
Michelle
version should say, through the fire and the flames. He set my feet on solid ground and steadied me as I walked along. This is my favorite part. He has given me a new song to sing, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see what he has done and be amazed, and they will put their trust in the Lord. Many will see what he has done and be amazed, and they will put their trust in the Lord. Can I share with you a little secret? I don't know if I've told many of you this, but because of our injury, my brother and I had
to go through
amputations, and extremities such as fingers and toes had been amputated. But let me tell you, that has not stopped me at all. Despite that, I learned how to play piano, and I play piano, and when I lead worship, when I've led worship before, I do it with piano, and people will always ask me, how do you do it? You know, they're so curious, and they say it's the grace of God. It's just another miracle that he has done to allow me to praise him and say thank you for what you have done. So, just a piece of scripture that I really identify with. But you guys are probably saying, okay, Michelle, this is great, but I'm not really sure how this relates to my everyday. Something that I think has really helped me, of course, is being close to the Lord and my family and the community, but here's a piece that I really want you to consider and think about. Oh, just kidding, before I get there, I want to show you some pictures. Excuse me. These are some of the things that I've gotten to do through what's happened to us, and I think the way that I've chosen to look at life. So I've gotten to meet amazing people who are in the burn community. I've gotten to speak and be an advocate for this community, for confidence, for children and families around the world who are not sure if they're going to have a positive future. It's been an opportunity to share my story and what God has done in my life. He has given me the ability to work in the States to help children internationally to get medical care for their burns, and to provide parties and gifts and stuff like that to support for them and their families. I've gotten to meet amazing people from different countries and children who have gone through similar injuries and to just encourage them. And most recently, I've gotten to do some research talking about the importance of support groups and just talking about trauma and having open communication and dialogue. But yes, my question that I had for you is this one. How do I use my words? This is something that has really changed the way that I've looked at life. I have a question. I have some thoughts that I'd like you to think about. How many times have we said some of these things to ourselves, whether out loud or we've thought them? I can't do this. I've actually heard people say, oh, I'm dumb. I'm so this and that. I forget everything. And let me tell you, I've heard this. My grandparents just went home, and I heard this one a lot. They kept saying, I'm too old to learn how to use an iPad. I'm too old to try wearing bootcut jeans. And I'm like, let me tell you, Grandma, okay, you look fabulous. Also, I agree about the ponchos. So excited they're coming back. Super cute. But things like this, you know, I'm a bad mom. I'm a bad grandparent. I'm a bad friend. I'm not good enough. How many times in the past couple of months, the past couple of weeks, yesterday or today, have we said that or thought that? Why is it that us as women are so hard on ourselves? You know, we see ourselves and say, oh, this dress is just, you see everything in this dress. Or you say, you know, oh, no, I gotta cut my hair, this is not working for me. We're just very critical of ourselves. Why is that? I'd like to do a quick exercise. I would like to invite you to look to your partner, either to your left or to your right now. Look to see who is your partner beside you. Okay, say hello, partner. Excellent. Okay, I want to invite you, we're gonna take 1 minute to do this because I know that we're running on time here. I'm gonna give you 20 seconds to look at your partner and I want you to think of a compliment to give your partner, the person beside you. 20 seconds to think about a compliment. Hang on. Okay, go ahead. but I'll just like take the head nods. How many of you were not expecting that compliment? All right, yeah, okay. All right, ladies. How many of you possibly said, oh no, you didn't quite accept the compliment. They said, oh, this thing, oh no, or how many of you, was it hard to accept the compliment? Some of us, yeah. Okay, this is my challenge for you, and this is kind of where I'm going to end this, is the fact that the enemy so many times will not allow us to accept a compliment. The enemy so many times will not allow us to see how God has created us to be. So many times we accept those lies, you know, and so I invite you today, this week, this upcoming year, to make that your mission, is to, whenever we start thinking these things, which has helped me to feel confident in who I am, is to say these kind of things too. Instead of saying, I can't do it, I'm able, I am strong, I am smart, I have knowledge, and if I don't, I can learn. Let me tell you, I can learn. I am beautiful, I am unique, I am created with purpose. That doesn't end after 20 years, 40 years, 6 years. That is every single day He has created us with purpose. And even though we go through struggles and difficult times and uncertainties, not just in our lives, in those of our spouse, in those of our family members, of our children and grandchildren, we are created with purpose. And if we are still here every single day, it's because God's not done with your plan yet. And that's the most important piece that we need to remember, is that, how do you see yourself? Tell me, how do we see ourselves? We are fabulous kittens, ladies. Come on, we are fabulous kittens, but we have to choose every day to see ourselves the way God has created us. As a fabulous, fierce lion. And that is the truth. We are not just moms, we are not just grandmas, we are not just friends. We are ambassadors of truth. We are ambassadors of self-esteem and confidence, and that's the mission that we have every single day. So this is my family. This is in Christmas this past year. My baby brother is now taller than me and acts like he's my older brother, let me tell you. This is our, as we call him very lovingly, this is our senior of the house right here. 16 years old, Brownie. Now we call him Beigey because he's no longer Brownie. And my parents. And so we still have our struggles, we still have our things, but at the end of the day, we've decided to put our trust in God and realize that every day He has us here with purpose. Thank you guys so much.
Michelle has a God confidence, doesn't she? With all that she's been through, she has the confidence to wear a sundress, and her scars are visible, but she knows who she is in the Lord. And God brings good out of evil and of hurt, doesn't He? And my word, she's been a blessing to so many people. And we're so blessed to have heard your story today, and for you to come and share it with us. May God bless you in all that you do, all the good works that you're doing. Thank you so much. I'm going to pray and lead us in prayer for just a minute after, but our next coffee hour is the 24th of October.